Thank you. we love you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. How many know his name is beautiful today?
Healing glory. church worships. And when you worship, you can't worship without engaging what's in your heart. So the lyric of this song, I don't know if they thought of this when they wrote it, but it's true. The earth will shout your praise, but our hearts will cry. These bones will shake while the earth is shouting its praise. There's something going down on the inside that is churning, that won't stop. And great are you, Lord, is what we can come up with. Somebody shout, great are you, Lord. God and the sacrifice that's been made in the person of Jesus as our Lamb, our substitution Lamb, when you know all these details and study all of the things that led us to how we can stand here today and celebrate and shout and sing that song, because the Lord is good and is worthy to be praised. He's always worthy. To look back down through the years, ministry, the Lord has blessed us to have a family, the lives of some of you, as I've shared moments that you've been brought to,
but we needed to call upon God. And in the faithfulness of God, God would do what only He can do. As we cry out to Him continuously, knowing He is worthy. Nothing is in vain when you worship God. When you study His Word, you pray to Him, believe Him, and trust Him. You want to pray. I want you to understand and know, in regards to the mountain of a situation you are dealing with, it is our God, the faithfulness of our God, who is faithful. 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 When you don't put it in His hands, you're literally saying, I got this. It's one thing. When we say, I got this, and refuse to take it to the Lord in prayer, you're literally canceling out the opportunity for change. God is the only one that can change and move your situation. Let's face it, if you could fix it in your own strength, it would be fixed by now. Those things that we can adjust and fix and make, do we do? Because God wants us to operate within the strength we have. But man's extremities are God's opportunities. Anybody in that extreme moment? Not every area of your life, but you have an area of your life. If you're breathing, there's an area of your life that is at an extreme, and only God can handle it. Only God can move it. So man's extremities are indeed God's opportunities. We need to give God that opportunity. Because when we place it in His hands, I know I sound like a broken record, but it's true. When you place it in His hands, you have placed it in the best hands possible. So as we come before God and pray, praying for our children, our grandchildren, our sisters, our brothers, we're praying for our job, we're praying for relationships, we're praying for guidance, direction, we're praying that God would bring into our life that which He wants us to have, and then take out that which He don't want there. We pray for His perfect will to be done. We avail ourselves. We ask God to give us ear to hear in this confused day in which we live in, where men don't even understand their men, women don't even understand their women. We are living in a very confused age. We pray for God's guidance and peace. Babies are being aborted just like nothing. All of it at all. Doctors are performing these atrocities and don't feel the convicting power that you are committing murder. Life is being snatched away. Drive-by shootings on the rampage. Crime is riddled our streets. Don't you tell me we don't need the capable hands of our God to move in our midst. Our political system is crumbling right before our eyes. And as they take the latest polls, things are at its most deplorable lows they could ever be. We need God. We need Him right now. Father, as we cry out to You, as we look to You as our source and strength, our help in ages past, our hope, come. Ask that You would move, that You would touch, heal, and deliver, that You would open the door. Bless You, strengthen them, meet need in their life. Father, as we attempt to do Your will, I pray, Father, for guidance and direction. I pray, Father, that we would have an ear in tune with You. Lord, in the days of radio, I know a lot of people don't listen to radio now, but they had to fine-tune the station just to get it right. If it wasn't fine-tuned, we wouldn't be able to receive a clear message that was coming forth. Father, oh, how we need to be in tune with You. Incline our ears to hear Your voice and Yours only. Help us in this generation, Father, to represent You rightfully and declare truth and love. Father, I pray, Lord, that You would give us a heart to love and let love draw them in. With loving kindness, You've drawn us. Give us a heart of love. Let us not get so high-minded and so caught up in what we're doing that we forget about those who are less fortunate, Father. whatever capacity and way we can. Father, I pray, Lord, that you would allow us to have that love that shows from heart to heart. Father, I pray for the needs of your people. Some are in need more than they want to talk about. Father, I pray that you would meet need in their life. Lord, I pray, Lord, that just like David, Lord, that you would provide only you can. Father, I pray, Lord, that you would heal the brokenhearted, bind up their wounds. Let a healing word come forth. I thank you that you love us so. You would draw us to this place. You would give us a word. We thank you for it. Father, I pray for our families, our children, grandchildren, nieces, nephews, sisters and brothers. Save them, Father. Work in the affairs of their life. If it means you have to interrupt their comfort zone, then interrupt it. But let them come to the realization of their great need of you. Surrender the throne of their life to you. Father, I pray for that one that's bound and cannot get free on their own. They want to be free. I pray, Lord, that you would liberate them and set them free. Father, I pray for that saint that's going through. Keep considering, Lord, when will it end? When will it always be over? Father, I pray, Lord, that you would give them power in the press. As they press their way, give them strength to make it through. Bless us, Father, in this day. We'll be careful to give you the praise, the glory, and honor. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Our journey, I thought, was over, but God, in our heart, we're on this amazing journey, God of the mountain, God of the valley. The Lord impressed upon me through the life of someone we quite know all so well, there is one more mountain to climb. Say it with me, one more mountain to climb. Stand with me as we consider for our reading today, Genesis chapter 22, verses 1 and 2. Genesis 22, verses 1 and 2. I'm going to ask you to read along with me today. Let's read our text together. Let's begin. And it came to pass after these things, come on, that God did tempt Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, and he said, behold, here I am. And he said, take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest. Get thee into the land of Moriah and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I tell thee of. Say with me, I got one more mountain to climb. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you bring us through danger seen and unseen, Lord, and you brought us through this to take us through that, but yet prove that you are the God of the mountain and the valley. And Father, as we stand here today, Lord, to give you praise and glory, that you might speak a word into our hearts, Father. Father, I thank you, Father, that the infallible truth of your word is willing to speak to any heart that would humble itself and quiet itself enough for you to speak, Father. And I pray, Lord, that as we hear this word today, somebody would catch faith in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray as we hear this word today, somebody would realize that you're not through with them yet, that there's yet one more victory you're going to experience. There's yet one more for you to see, and you're going to be able to go and declare to the generation to come that the Lord is good and his mercy. But by your power, Lord, you deliver it. first in line of a long line of folk who chose to walk by faith, not by sight. I think that's a good introduction right there. Why this text is so familiar to us, what lies before us is the unfamiliar. And at least to me, I want to draw it out and think. Because we know this story. But we always know the story, don't we? So we think. It's only when we slow down. I told them on Bible study, you get these scriptures and you start going 80 miles down the road, 80 miles an hour, and God said, no. You're in a 20-mile-per-hour zone. Slow down. Right. Because you see what you see, you got to pull over. Mm-hmm. Pull your blanket out. Yeah. And let's have a peek. So the car got stopped in Genesis 22. And I had to pull over and get out and get a blanket. I found one in the sandwich.
Okay.
I found a meal sitting there. Wow. And I had to apologize because, wow, the text is familiar to me, being a preacher that have preached this over and over again. It is what is unfamiliar to me that God drawn out. Look at it. I don't know how long the time frame we're working with, but the Bible said it came to pass.
Yes.
A time passed, and Abraham has already at this time learned about God. For he has been in the mountain and he's been in the valley. But after a time passed, you would think it's over. Somebody said, one more.
One more.
He finds out there's one more mountain to climb. And it comes to pass. God brought him into such circumstances of mountains and valleys. And there in those mountains and valleys, God had taken this man, whose name at this point is Abraham, but when he started, his name wasn't Abraham, it was Abram. But by now, he's matriculated, he's grown in his faith, and God has now called him father of many nations. It's the Ham now on the Abram that gives us the Abraham. Because he has exercised his faith. It's not the values that added up to it. Where he's exercised, discovered his faith, his love, and obedience. Because you never know if you're going to obey God until he says, come out from your faith. You don't know what you're going to do until God presented it to you. Genesis chapter 10, 11, one of those chapters, God told him, I want you to leave your familiar to go to the unfamiliar. Never knew where the unfamiliar was. He was going, he was just following God. And God brought him into such circumstances of mountains and valleys just to exercise his faith. Say it with me. Baby steps.
Baby steps.
He took them steps. The first step was to step out. In Genesis 22, he's given them a whole other set of steps. But the first step was to go out, and he went out. He's growing in his faith to the place we get to Genesis chapter 22, and he now has a history with God of mountains and valleys where he's exercised and discovered his faith, his love, and his obedience. How about you? With all the mountains and everything you've been up against, all the valleys you've been in, has it discovered you love God? We went through this pandemic. There were some of you that had to fight through it. And we fought through it to maintain with God. Some took challenging steps of faith, which proved your faith, love, and obedience. It's a strong word used, tempt. But it's there, T-E-M-P-T in verse 1. God tempt Abram. Not tempting the way that we think, but implied that God does bring us to a place where we are tried and tested to allow us to see, because he already knows where we are. him one more time. He tested him one more time. Looked like every test was more ultimate than the other one. And yet, just when he thought life was about to get in cruise mode, you ever thought you got to get in cruise and all of a sudden you found out, kick it up a gear? Abraham is in a wonderful place. He's 100 years old. He has a baby. That means I still got it. Go ahead, Abe. And you know, he had Ishmael God had put out, and he has Isaac, and God has blessed him. What God has allowed to show him, and as well as you and I, why we don't like testing. Testing is good. It does interrupt our comfort. How comfortable can you be leaving your familiar to go to unfamiliar? Say it with me. Very uncomfortable. Testing that interrupt our comfort and joy. Life as our mountain is truly, it's hard to climb up that kind of mountain. Mm-hmm. Leave, go somewhere you've never been. Yet in Deuteronomy 8 and 2, it's on the screen. He said, I want you to remember this. This is Moses' instruction, and God has given it to Moses to give Israel. Remember all the way. Circle that, underline that, and score it. Because you have a multiplicity of things that God has done to get you to where you are. And you need to remember all the way God brought you. And I believe, my brothers and sisters, a lot of people get over here on the Lord's side and they get amnesia and forget. They forget that they too was where they're looking at somebody else at. They forget that they too was once in the lows and the dumps and the slumps. He said, I want you to remember all the way. And he gives the credit to the Lord. He led you 40 years. Wasn't always happy, wasn't always sad. But I got 40 years worth of experience here with God. He did all that to humble you, to prove, test to you, to know what was in your heart. The King James Hebrew is archaic as it says this. Because it's not that God had to discover anything. He had to show them what was in them. And that's why the greatest thing God can do for you is save you from yourself. You say, God saved me from my sin. Now, yeah, he saved you from your sin in a sense, but he saved you from you. Because if left to be you and do what you were doing, you would self-destruct. He said, I want you to remember what God did so that you would know what was in your heart and that whether you would keep his commandments or not. Abraham's response here is grand. I like this. God calls him, and he just simply comes to the place where his history unfolds. It's one of the ones you and I best join in with. It is one of someone who has a history with God. And has now come to the place that I don't have to question him, but obey him. So he comes to a place where it does not matter the what, when, why, or where. Say it with me, I'm here.
I'm here.
Genesis 22 and 21. 22 and 1 says, after all this time, here's another time come that God is going to test Abraham. He tests him and says unto him, Abraham. Now, you would think God would quit testing him this way, but he does it to him and you and I as well by calling you by your name to hear you ready to respond. So the first set of instructions is to call you by your name. The second step is for you to say, I'm here. Look at it. Don't let it pass you by. We read this trying to hurry up and get to the mountain with Isaac. And God's calling him. He has the ultimatum whether or not to say, I'm here, I'm available to you. Use me for your glory. He responds with an unequivocal, yes, Lord. Behold, here I am. What a patriarch crowning moment. He avails himself with a simple, here I am. What he has in his history is mountains and valleys in his life. One thing I want you to catch in this, the Bible says it came to pass. Oh, you didn't get it. I'm going to give it back. story adds up to what it is, it's because of these passing moments. Would you ever despise the things that you're going through? Peter put it this way in 1 Peter 1:7. The trial of your faith being much more precious than that of gold. You're so adamantly worried about the things you're collecting and the money you have and the job. And God said your faith being tested is more precious than any of that. Because at the end of the day, money will fail, but Jesus never fails. At the end of the day, your house can be burned up, but he does all things well. You got to have your faith intact. The trial of your faith being more precious, more important, more valuable, I might add, than that of gold. Though it be tried with fire. Being tried is one thing. But to be tried with fire, do we have to have the fire? Can't we just have the test? Test bad enough. You're going to put fire to it. Some of you done had a fire of a situation. Some of y'all done had your wallet fall, catch fire. I'm burning that, I'm just holding it. Some of y'all done had your car catch fire. Some of y'all had your marriage catch a fire. I know you don't want to admit it. Some of y'all had your children catch a fire. You have to call on God to put it out. He said the trial of your faith, though it be tried with fire, it comes under the intensity of scrutiny. It comes to the testing of the test where you think you cannot make it. You ever been there? You ever brought up to a mountain of a situation that you felt like this would be the one that would make me lose my mind, only to further grasp a hole in your mind and come back and say, God, you are a keeper of them, even in the storm. You keep us in perfect peace, and I just keep my mind stayed on you. He said, even if it's tried with fire, it might be found under praise, honor, and glory. Great words here. Lovely text. I love this passage. Praise, honor, and glory at the appearing of Jesus. So we have a journey of faith in a man who has many opportunities. And the faithfulness of his God has brought him time and time again. Look what God comes after. Your own test, this is a fiery thing now. And what do you come after? It would make sense to come after what we love, doesn't it? It makes sense to come after that which we want to keep. It makes sense to come after that which we work so hard to get. It makes more sense to come after that which you really don't want to give away. Verse 2 of Genesis 22. By the way, before I even read this verse, God gave up what he loved. Is he not worthy to test us in what we love? Take now your son. This only comes after he said, here am I. The first set of instructions was you to avail yourself to the will of God. For you to be willing to give God what he wants is to say, here I am. Not, I'm here, but not this area over here. I'm here, but don't touch this life. I'm going to keep that right there. Here I am opens the door for whatever God wants. So before you say, here I am, you might want to make sure you're really willing to say, here I am. Because what might come after it might very well be what you love. Well, take now the son. 21. Another man wanted her. He looked at her and said, "Woo.
Y'all quiet. Y'all ain't read Genesis 21? A king looked at her. They don't get them hand-me-down old women. They get them good, fine stallions and bring them into their, what they call it, carousal. What they call it? They call it harem. Some of y'all's esteem is too low. And I'm not talking about the kind of pride that you get all puffed up and out of yourself. But some of y'all got too much low esteem. Amen. While Sarah is saying, "I ain't got it," God was showing her, not only do you got it, another man wanted it. Abraham, you better pick up your game then, brother. The trajectory of the scriptures show that before all this happened, another man wanted her. Abraham is like, "Yes, Lord." And now God said, "Hold up. Take your son." I noticed God did not drop that on him right away. He just said, "Abraham." Abraham responded, "Why not? I just come off the mountain of a turmoil, and God has given me victory in the valley. My wife has just had a baby. Here I am. What else you want to do?" He didn't know what was coming. He just knows because you are God, and what you have done from the moment I stepped out to the place I am now, and now I got a son. Here I am. And there's some of you, no matter what you've been through and all that, you're willing to say, "Here I am." And some of y'all have just come down off the mountain of pure hell, and down in the valley you rejoice and clap only to hear God say, "Say, here I am." That Paul was your name. When God says, "Abraham," Abraham responded with a response that you would give and I would give if we were in his shoes too. "Here I am, God. What you want? Come on, what you want? Whatever you want, you can have it. What you want? As good as you've been to me, you can have it. I stepped out with nothing. And by the time I got to where I'm at, I was rich and had all kind of stuff." The first Egyptian king that wanted Sarah, the Bible said when God plagued the house and stopped all the wounds, God really went off in a violent rage against this man and gave him back his wife and gave him an offering. He gave him an offering. It wasn't no little bit of offering either. And the Bible said Abraham was rich. He was increased with cattle and servants and all that stuff. So when God called, you bet your ham socks he's going to answer, "Here I am." He didn't know verse 2 exists. We're reading this story in retrospect. But Abram was living in that moment. And in that moment, he didn't know he was about to get one more mountain to climb. And God called him and he said, "Here I am." God didn't drop that on him first because he probably wouldn't have responded. So he called him, got his name. And then he says, could you imagine how he felt when he heard this? Look at this. "Take now your son." I can give you the rest of this information now because I have your undivided attention. "Take now your son, your only son." And then he hid him whom you love. "And get thee into the land of Moriah." That means he got to go on a journey. He got to get him there and then offer him. Somebody say sacrifice. Offer him there the burnt offering. And look at this. This is where I got messed up. Go ahead and say, "You always get messed up."
You always get messed up.
This is what messed me up. Brother Hopper just jacked me up so bad, I said, I got to share it. Okay. He said, "You give him up in the land of Moriah and offer him there a burnt offering upon one of the mountains." This ain't the only mountain I got, but it's just one of
going up. It's one of many that you will go up and come down on. It's one amongst those that you have been up and down, and now you're going up on another one. Offer him upon one of the mountains, which I tell you, which tells me God had more than one mountain for him to climb. That's where I got it from. He said, I want you to get up on one of the mountains, which I will tell you. I've led you up a mountain before, and now I got another one for you. This is just one among many. And those of you who don't want to hear it again, as you know who those are, those are folks who think because they suffer one time, God owed them, and they're supposed to go around blaming on that one blessing. Guess what? Many are the afflictions of the righteous. You're going to go through more than that. You're going to see more than that. You're going to get to the place where you're going to know God without a shadow of a doubt. Take now your son. You get it now, don't you? Take him up on one of the mountains. Was there other mountains I could have went up with this boy? We could have went up the mountain of praise and just went up and praised. You want me to go up the mountain of sacrifice? Most of us conclude we know the story. Yet in the unfamiliar part of this story, we find God bringing this man to a place of, and if you do the research, one of the Hebrew words for mountain is promotion. God said, look, boy, I'm bringing you to one of those levels, but I'm going to promote you and your faith. You didn't have the faith when you first started to offer your son, but you had the faith to step out, and I promoted you from that. And the Bible said, when God looked at Abraham and told him, you're going to be the father of many nations, the Bible said Abraham believed, and God accounted it to him for righteousness. So he promoted him because he believed God. Let me tell you what faith will do. Faith will bring you to a mountain where God will promote you in your faith. So he went from believing God to step out from his family, loved ones, inheritance, land, all of that stuff that go with it, to going somewhere he did not even know. And from the very beginning of the journey, things got tough. But now he's at a place where God is saying, I want you to take this son one more time. God is getting ready to promote him in his faith. And many of you, while you're going up the mountain and coming down, and I told you last week, it is a succession in your life where you're going up the mountain, coming down. Each time you're learning something, there's a glory that is to be learned from coming down off that mountain. But the tragedy of the anguish of going up that mountain hurt. It hurts. This is shocking him. This is taking his reality into a place that makes him think. You and I as well. Take your son, your only son. Offer him. He know what that meant. Y'all, watch this now. As he brings this man to a place where he's going to promote him, it is one more time amongst many times that God will promote him. We had an exercise machine at our old house. Thankfully, we sold it. Got rid of it. But this machine, you could walk on it at a level. Now, they would come outside while I'm walking on it, and some of them would have fun with me, and they would hit a button that made it incline. And it was the same strain as it was you walking up a mountain. Now, walking level, I was fine. Going good pace, everything. Did a good sweat. But when I started that up climb, and they started me going up like I'm going up a mountain, my legs started hurting, calf muscles started aching. The journey up that mountain hurt so bad, I stopped pushing that button to go back down because I didn't like the way I felt going up because it hurt. And y'all, there's things in life. Going up it hurts. While you see it unfolding, it hurts. journey up the mountain. But I must admit to him and to you and I, the journey will be worth it. But the way up can take a toll on you. This is why I want to say what I'm going to say. And I promise you, we're going to be done quicker than you think. If you don't worship, if you don't worship, if you don't have a heart that is resolved to worship, whether you're on the mountain or in the valley, it's going to get the best of you. Bible says in Psalms 34 and 19, it's on the screen. Many are the afflictions of the righteous.
Yes.
Somebody say, I've been through something. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. But the Lord brings them out of them all. But going into it ain't easy. Going into it ain't pleasant. Going up that mountain knowing I gotta do this. If your heart is not engaged to worship, anybody can give an offering. But it is the heart that refuses to worship that despises the mountain. Because when you despise the mountain, you're going up. You get that syndrome. God must hate me. I must have did something. You need to remember this verse. God ain't ripping you. He's about to show you something. You're going up a mountain for glory. It is the purpose of God showing himself strong. If I never had a problem, I wouldn't know he could solve them. If I never had a problem in my marriage, I wouldn't know what healing is. If I never had a child acting up, I would never know what the power of God can do. So I can be able to say with the assurance and the kind of reality that make it more than just a song, that through it all, I learned to trust in Jesus. Through it all, I learned to depend on God. Through it all, somebody lift your hands and worship. Through it all, I learned. Through the bankruptcy, through the life, through the divorce, through the heart.
You need to let your worship take you up there.
left mom and dad, stepped out with God. If you start with God, you can end with God. He's faithful. I feel a preacher coming up on me now. If you start with God, you can end with God. No matter where he take you, whether in the valley, it's all right. Whether up on the mountain, it's all right. Because my strength does not come from horses and chariots. I don't get power out of my blue cross and blue shields. God, the Lord is my keeper. The Lord is my shade in the sun. The Lord, he is my right hand. He is my everything. Turn your hand and celebrate him. The Lord is.
Y'all stay right here, because if God want me to cut him, y'all will probably stop me. And y'all being strong, and I'm old, I can't fight all y'all off. And you might see me obeying God as an atrocity against nature, but I'm just reckless in my faith. I believe if I kill the boy, God's going to raise him up. I believe if he die, God's going to resurrect him. I believe if he get ugly, God's going to make it pretty. I believe if he get the weeping that endured for a night, till it coming in the bus, coming in the morning. I believe it's going to get ugly up here, y'all. And you're not going to be able to handle it. I'm going to have to go, because trouble is in my way. I have to cry sometime, make a wake at night, but that's all right. Hallelujah. Jesus is going to fix it. Hallelujah.
And if you're not careful, in the year 2022, you will get your sacrifice confused with your worship. The reason why you sacrifice is because of your heart of worship. If you're just sacrificing the sacrifice, then you're just grudgingly giving. You're just grudgingly doing. But when you worship, when you resolve to worship, you realize this is an act of obedience that honors God. God had a problem. what he has asked for is unacceptable. In worship, we give God what he wants, not what we want him to have. And remember, when Abram gives testimony to the coming generation, he will have testimony of many mountains and valleys. Do you not think he didn't continue to tell that story? God told me to take my son. Well, it started many years ago. God told me to step out. I was a young little boy, and I stepped out. And God waited until I was 100-year-old to give me a child, and then asked me to take him. Come on, can you not hear that story around the fire? God asked me to take him up on the mountain, and I had no better sense than to go up there. And because I had service with me, I had to stop them before I go all the way up. Because when I got up there, I didn't need no distraction. And just as I had the knife under my shirt, ready to come.
Well, when God will unfold it, all of a sudden, no more God.
God's will. Anger and bitterness and everything came up. Folks, the journey up the mountain gives us no guarantee of how we come down. Make sure you have. In the natural, if you go mountain climbing, they tell you you need water, you need protein, you need to be in good health. Because the journey up a mountain will kill you. Many of people trying to go up these highest mountains and die trying to do it. And I'm talking, man, you go and you can watch this stuff. These folks go up a mountain and the only place they have to sleep is where they stick their stabs in the rock and make a little spot. They crazy. But they go up that mountain and some have fallen and died doing it. And they know people have died doing it and yet they take it on. Why? The Brandonites are having climbed that mountain. Get some world famous status. Gives them a sense of accomplishment, doesn't it? Folks, when you go up life's mountain, and others quit and you continue to go, and you learn something about God you would not have learned as you went up the mountain. You'll never cease to come to one or the other. You will always have mountains and valleys. But the one thing that must stay the same is your worship. You must worship. You must learn, watch this, how to prophesy over your own self. While you're on one of those mountains and unsure what's going to happen, you must with piercing eyes look to your generation coming up behind you, scared, not knowing, ain't as mature to think as you are. You must look at them and say, my son, verse 8 of 22, my son. My son, don't leave it out. My son, you just don't know like I know. I've been here before. God will. I've been here. Me and First Lady climbed many mountains. We've been so broke, man. We've been down. You know what I mean? We've been there with you. We have had obstacles. And just as the bitterness set in, God will bring us down. Am I right about that, honey? I mean, I can't begin to tell you. I don't want you to think I'm bragging, but I'm telling you, we have looked up the piercing side of that mountain thinking, how am I going to climb this? How am I going to do this as a man taking a woman out of a man's house? I feel bad that we have gotten this place. I feel sad that I have done this. What an embarrassment to take this man's daughter out of his house where he had her protected and put her out to this, and this happened. Only God, y'all, can bring it down. Abraham does what we must do for our generation. Who is wondering, will we ever get out of the mask? Will we ever get behind this thing? Will we ever be able to move forward? We look at our sons and our daughters and say, God will provide. He will provide. That's so reassuring to this boy. Because y'all, in the tenor of the text, look at this. The journey has stopped. Because Abraham has to answer to the generation that is looking to him for answers. What do you say when the journey is going and you're happy? You done left them other people with the animals and you're going up. Now the journey done come to a stop because your son don't understand what's going on. And you got to give them something to keep them moving. Come on, y'all, hear me. You got to give them something that will help them take another step. You got to give your daughter something that will help her get in right with God. You got to help them do something. He said, God will provide. And you must be a prophet to this generation and let them know God will provide. One thing I want to tell you before I leave. If you are going to speak to your generation and tell them God will, then you better make sure you have things in order. Your life needs to be in order with God. The Bible says they got to the place in verse 9. They got to the place. And I'm telling you, you got to make sure you got things in order. On the mountain or in the valley, have this priority in your life that you want God's blessings. You've got to get it in order. They came to the place where God told them of. Abraham built the altar. And watch the flow of this. He laid the wood in order. Bound Isaac, his son, and laid him on the wood. This is the way it was supposed to be. The wood, the sacrifice, put it in order. Some of y'all, and I love you dearly, but until you get the order in your life right, things will never get right for you. Things are out of order. God ain't even number one no more. He's a far third. Some of you, the order of your life was so you would never miss God. And I'm not trying to control or mind bog anybody, but I'm telling you, when the order is out of order, you can never expect God's order. Used to be a time you would never miss church. You would never just lay out. Now we just find any excuse, any reason to not be faithful. When was the last time you opened your Bible at your house and read it? No wonder things are out of order. First things first. Maybe you are here. Just like Abraham, you need to get it in order. But if you expect the fire to come and consume your offering, you have to have it. God took him on this mountain. It's here in the same mountain that David would offer an offering unto the Lord. And they would build a temple on it. It's in the same mountain prophetically that it's prophesied the Lord himself will provide. It's a shadow of what's coming thousands of years later as Jesus would come, our substitution. He who knew no sin. Maybe you're here and you know things are out of order in your life. This is your chance to get it in order. This is the opportunity to change so that the mountain of the issue in your life will not get the best of you. I close with Psalms 95, 1 through 6. Come on, stand as I read this. Oh, come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. And make a joyful noise unto him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands, watch verse 4, in his hands are the deep places, that's the valley. The strength of the hills, that's the mountain, are his also. It all belongs to him. The sea is his, he made it. His hands formed the dry land. And then he said, oh, come, let's worship. Let's get a lifestyle of obedience that whether we're in the deep places or whether we're up on the hills in the high of the mountains, let's worship. Let's bow down. Let's kneel before the Lord, our Maker. You're here today. You have not been on this journey by accident. I thought we were done, and God said, no, one more mountain to climb. Because you are going to go through, you're going to come out, you're going to go in, you're going to come out. You're going to come up and come down, but what must stay the same? The order of your life must be resolved that I'm going to worship. worship. Go to worship. So I gotta come. I gotta bow to heaven. I gotta worship. I gotta give him praise. Some of you got a mountain. I mean, it's a mountain of a mess going on in your life. Hell on every end. Job, children, grandkids. I mean, you name it. There's problems, man. It's a mountain. And the only way to journey up that mountain, you can sustain it, is your worship. You gotta worship. You gotta bow down. Don't lose your sense of worship. Don't get so caught up in what's going on that you can't worship. Hallelujah. Let me get bowed. Let me hide from this. Bow down and worship him. Eternity. Come on, it's worship time. Respond to the word. Oh, worship him. Come on, let's worship the Lord a little bit. Bow down. Word. Father, we come to this mountain. Lord, rather than stand up straight, we bow down before you. The God of our marriage, the God of our children, the God of our circumstance, the God of our mountain, the God of our valley. Lord, we need you. We are so wrong for trying to make it without you. But oh God, we come to set things in order. Forgive us, Lord. And as we repent, Lord, we turn to you. And we realize, Lord, in our own strength, it is helpless. In our own strength, it is useless. But, oh God, we call upon you today. Help us. We got to go up this mountain, Lord, and up on that mountain is not pretty. But you have ordained this mountain so that we can get a testimony of your grace. Help us. Help us, oh God.
Thank you for every mountain, for every valley, for
Through it all, I know, Lord, doctors have a certain wisdom, and you got greater wisdom, Lord. Through it all, I learned, Lord, that bodies can respond to medicine, and you call the medicine not to work. Through it all, I learned, Lord, that all of man's attempts have to bow to your sovereign and perfect and true will. And Lord, even though we know not the day or the hour, the one thing we do know is that you that begun a good work, you are faithful. Help us to be found among the faithful in this generation. The faithful that will love you, the faithful that will worship you, the faithful that will bow down and give you worship, whether we're in the valley or on the mountain or on the journey up or the journey down. To God be the glory for the things he has done. Thank you, Lord.
One more mountain to climb. I know you're tired of suffering.